Thanks for joining us for another edition of Issues and Answers. I'm Ian Boyne. Today we talk about an issue that is uppermost in the minds of all of us, the issue of security. We are all concerned about crime. We have with us the Minister of National Security, the Honorable Peter Bunting, and we'll be asking him about the initiatives to deal with this vexing issue. We thank you so much for your company. Minister, good to have you on the show. There are a number of laudable strategies that the ministry has, a number of them short term. But there are some immediate things, Minister, that need to be done. There is an immediate curtailment of this surge in crime. What is the ministry going to be doing? What new will be done to deal with this issue?
Well, there are a combination of things by both the ministry and its agencies. So almost immediately, the security forces, the police taking the lead but supported by the JDF, are going to initiate what they call surge operations. That is, they're going to increase the presence of the security forces on the street 24 hours right across the island.
We're going to be seeing more police and soldiers on the road.
More police and soldiers. The infantry of the JDF is going to be deployed in support of the police, particularly in parishes like St. James, Westmoreland, Hanover, Clarendon, as well as the usual St. Catherine and the corporate area. Mm-hmm. We are going to see, for the first time deployed operationally, the new squadron of protected mobility vehicles, what used to be referred to as armored personnel carriers. Uh-huh. And these will be especially useful in areas where you have heavily armed gangs. Okay. And also in the rural terrain, sometimes the informal communities around Montego Bay or in some of the other rural areas where the normal patrol cars, etc., might find it difficult to operate. So you should see this presence starting now,
right now,
and ramping up as you go towards Christmas. It will become even more amplified.
This is new, protected mobility vehicles.
This is
deployed.
You will recall the last time, I think it was in the 70s, that you had a significant investment.
Yes.
In what was then the V-150s, the armored personnel vehicles. And since that time, there has been no reinvestment in that capability. And over the last couple of years, we have put a substantial capital budget to acquire this capability. And you are now going to see the deployment of the first set of vehicles this week.
Yes. Other initiatives, Minister?
As you're aware, we have identified scamming as one of the sources of murders, really, and you know, the fueling of the purchase of illicit guns. The proceeds of scamming fuels the purchase of illicit guns and bikes and cars for criminals and criminal gangs. So one of the challenges around being more effective in attacking this is that we find, particularly in Western Jamaica, it is not looked on as the serious crime it is. It tends to be, you know, there's been a lot of sophisticated propaganda about it. Mm-hmm. People call it reparations.
Yes.
People say it's a victimless crime. People say it's a sort of Robin Hood, mm-hmm. robbing from the rich and giving to the poor. Of course, it's all rubbish, because the victims are the most vulnerable elderly people who are just living off their little savings, and that is what is robbed from them by scammers. So we're starting a public education campaign, because we realize that you have to start with changing the norms, reaching, you know, appealing to the, in a sense, changing the hearts and minds mm-hmm. of people before you will, you know, see the behavior yes. change. And we have a whole public education campaign that we're sponsoring, media, traditional media, as well as social media, really bringing home to people, connecting the dots between the activities of scamming and the extraordinarily high levels of murder that we're seeing in Area 1 now.
And it is the plan of your ministry, minister and of the JCF to have about 80% of the force on the road. You want to have fewer people doing, fewer police officers doing desk work.
Absolutely. The commissioner wants at least 80% of the JCF on the road doing operational type activities. Mm-hmm. So there's going to be a scaling back of the administrative activities between now and the end of the year. This generally happens at Christmas time.
Anyway.
But what we're doing is pulling it forward, maybe by a month, 3 weeks or a month, so that we can start to have an impact.
So almost immediately, this will be done.
Immediately, yes.
Yes. We're speaking to the Minister of National Security, the Honourable Peter Bunting, on the vexing issue of crime and security. He's telling us of some of the initiatives which are being undertaken to deal with this current surge. He has more to tell us when we come back from our break.
This is Diane Edwards from JAMPRO. Stay tuned, you're watching Issues and Answers on Jamaica Magazine with Ian Boyne.
Welcome back. Minister of National Security, the Honourable Peter Bunting, is our guest. Minister, isn't it the fact that because the government is under this IMF program and this program of austerity, that the security sector has been starved of investments? That one of the reasons for the increase in crime is that we have not been putting the kinds of investments in security that we ought to. What's your response to that?
Well, first of all, let me say that I don't think any ministry of government is getting the type of budget that it would like to get. We could always use more. But I can say that I think we have, given the austerity program, given the constraints, we have nonetheless been able to invest a tremendous amount in mobility, mm-hmm. in equipment, in modernizing our telecommunications, etc. Just to give you an example in terms of just vehicles,
yes.
for the police, we've spent well over $1 billion on that over the last 4 years. We've probably spent closer to $1.5 billion
just for the
police. We've spent hundreds of millions upgrading the telecommunications infrastructure, radios, vehicle tracking system, computer-aided dispatch. We've spent, again, a couple hundred million dollars upgrading the software to aid our investigators in terms of the automated palm and fingerprint identification system, in terms of giving them mobile fingerprint scanners so that when they are on the road conducting operations, if they arrest somebody who they suspect is wanted for other crimes or is they were on bail and they jumped bail, etc., they can make a positive identification of that person on the road or in a rural police station rather than having to bring them back to the center to establish their identity. We have put a lot into strengthening our intelligence capability. Mm-hmm. And, you know, obviously not those capabilities you're not going to speak to publicly because you need an element of surprise for some of them. But let me just say we have strengthened the relationships with our international partners.
Okay.
Only earlier this week we signed a memorandum of cooperation with the United States where they're going to share the criminal histories of persons who are being deported to Jamaica. This was not something that was done previously, even though there are, you know, thousands of Jamaicans who have been convicted in the US who have been deported over the last many years.
This is significant.
But I think it represents a deepening of the trust, mm-hmm. between our administrations and between our law enforcement agencies. And I think this will help us to be able to assess, you know, who represents the real threats, uh-huh. of the thousands that have come back.
So you can concentrate.
Some might
your
come
efforts.
Back for relatively minor things. Some might be, you know, persons who are wanted for, or sort of rather who have been convicted for narcotics trafficking, mm-hmm. serious violent crimes, that sort of thing.
So that they have that information.
We'll now be getting that information. So our intelligence people will be able to do an appropriate surveillance. Mm-hmm.
Minister, what's happening with the mobile apps? You had announced that there would be this app.
Stay Alert app.
We could report. You know,
absolutely.
Citizens it could is, report.
It is operating.
It's operating.
It is operating. Many people have downloaded it and are using it. We are promoting it to groups like neighborhood watches. We have used the opportunity at the orientation sessions of universities and schools, various community colleges, teachers' colleges, to introduce the app, to circulate flyers and encourage people to download. It's free, and they can use it to provide information or intelligence to the NIB. There is a facility that does that. They can also use it as a panic button to send a distress call, as an alternate means of contacting police control in an emergency, and particularly where they may not be able to make a call without alerting somebody that they're doing that. So many people have actually, you know, what the police tell me is that almost as most people, as soon as they download it, they try it, even though it's not at an emergency.
Yes.
And then they express surprise that they actually get a call back to find out, you know, if it's genuine, what has happened. So it is there, it's working. Yeah. We're going to continue to develop it. We're going to continue to develop other ways to use social media, for example, to facilitate persons reporting suspicious activity, persons passing on tips anonymously, that sort of thing.
What are you doing about 119? Can you get 119 to work to answer?
119, we have just spent a significant amount of money. Part of the telecommunications upgrade was to upgrade the 119 system. The previous system that we had been using, in fact, had passed its useful life many years ago. The suppliers didn't even support it anymore. We have just installed a new system. I think we're going through the teething pains, but I expect that it's going to represent a significantly improved level of service to customers, to citizens, and responsiveness when they call.
Thank you very much, Minister of National Security, the Honorable Peter Bunting, talking to us about the critical issue of security. He'll be back next week. We have other issues to put to him on this important issue. Until then, this is Ian Bourne wishing you a pleasant day.